Let's get Do you that. Wanna be great? Do you wanna be great? Do you wanna be great? Do you wanna be great? Ah, kia ora te whānau, nau mai hoki mai, ki tēnei kaupapa, kia nei, whakatō I te kākano, otherwise known as the Planting Seeds Podcast. Welcome everybody, happy as to really be jumping into this podcast with someone who's really sort of navigated the space that a lot of Māori are sort of walking in at the moment, in terms of business, in terms of hauora, in terms of redefining what it means to be Māori as well as to be healthy. It's my brother, Tiare. No mai, my bro.
Kia ora rā mātou, my brother. Welcome to my whare.
Bro, beautiful whare, like everybody. Those of you who are listening, I hope you can just sort of feel because the energy that the brother and Lace have in their whare, it's just so, there's a sense of just zen. You know, it's just real toe in here.
Oh, kia ora, my brother.
Oh, bro, so happy to have you on, bro. How's things been going?
It's been good, my brother. Busy. But a good busy, but waimari katoa, brother. I'm so grateful as ever to be here, especially in your presence. Waro te wa.
Yeah.
I'm so really looking forward to it.
Oh, awesome, bro. So for the listeners who are tuning in at the moment, just give a bit of an update or outline of who you are, your upbringing, and sort of, you know, what you're about, bro, just so people can paint the picture.
Kia ora. Kia ora I te iwi. Tiare Tawera is the name. I was born and bred in Whakatāne, but I moved up to Whakatāne around about 1999 and grew up here in Auckland, living life. I'm very grateful to grow up in the presence of my beautiful mum. As time progressed, went through this journey of life and learning all these, you know, the biggest struggle for me, whānau, is that I struggled to speak English, and, you know, that was... really, really hard being here in Tāmaki Makaurau. So I went through kura, struggling to speak English. Didn't learn to speak English until third form. So I went to Hato Petara College, and it was my drive to learn te reo Pākehā, to learn, te awe huri nei, and embrace that going through Hato Petara College. Very fortunate enough to get ducks at my kura. And since then... I pretty much went on a journey of just being young, you know, living the YOLO life. finished playing rugby, sports. Wasn't able to play sports because I actually was fortunate enough to be a TV presenter on Pukana. But what had happened, got into the drinking alcohol, the party life, the excess consumption of calories, and I put on a whole heap of weight. In 2009, my beautiful daughter was born. And so she was the motivating factor for me to make that positive change. And I wanted to be the change that I wished to see in her. So I started to embark this journey of health and fitness, learned from a few different coaches, but majority just learning by myself and, you know, going, you know, eating healthy foods, training, etc. To cut a long story short, lost a lot of weight. And then I got addicted to health and fitness. And just for everyone to know, but... I put on so much weight after kura, like to the point I got up to 119 kgs for myself. I'm very puto, very short, so that's really, really big. So I put on all this weight, lost all that weight, and once again got addicted to living a healthier lifestyle. And that led me into competing. I've done multiple different competitions. I've coached myself along the way. But during this journey as well, I literally had this feeling within me like, man, a lot of people need to learn this as well, because if I went through that struggle, what can I do to give back to our iwi? What can I do to give back and share this knowledge to help people make that positive change in their lives? So I started my own business called Tawera Fitness, about 9 years ago, and it just took off. And in regards to the nutrition and training plans, I created that based on my knowledge, based on me being a competitive athlete and what I did to get into the best shape of my life. Mm. Tawera Fitness has pretty much sculpted my entire journey. It's been my anchor. It's been sort of my driving force every single day to use that, you know, health and fitness. What health and fitness did for me, it transformed my whole life. You know, my health was my wealth. So... started Tawera Fitness, and once again, in the space of 9 years, I've been able to help over 5,000 online clients. And currently right now, we've got about 3,600 online clients in Tawera Fitness that are thriving and doing extremely well. But ever since then, though, I think the struggle that I went through is that people would do my programs for, you know, 12 weeks. They'd lose a lot of weight, but the moment they finished the program, they put on all this weight. And then back to the old ways they went. And for me, it didn't sit well with me because, you know, I was offering the service, but it wasn't changing. It wasn't really changing their lives.
Sustainably.
So, which led me into my new path. And I created a new program called The Awakening. And what The Awakening is truly awakening the inner leader within us. So our inner being. And what I've come to realize is that, you know, the external changes are not really going to change your life. So we focused on the diet plans, the training plans. It's not really going to create the sustainable results for you. It's about changing the mindset, changing the internal world. And that's why I created The Awakening. And ever since then, my journey so far is not just health and fitness. It's about being a mindset coach, a mentor, a role model, and teaching people the power of their thoughts. If they can change their thoughts, they can change their mindset, they can change their lives. And ever since then, we've had multiple companies from Tawera Fitness, The Awakening. Now we have our financial literacy course, the Law of Attraction course, high ticket program. We have Pua Wai, and we also have other side businesses that we're running at the moment. And yeah, very, very grateful. But I think it all stemmed from, you know, being a part of this health and fitness journey.
Far out. E te whānau, like, I've just been here aggressively shaking my head and nodding my head this whole entire time because I'm like, you know, I've witnessed the brother actually sort of do everything that he sort of said. And, you know, he was born and raised in Whakatane, which is like my hometown. So this sinks even a little bit deeper, like for myself, you know, just coming from the same sort of backgrounds. But, you know, just to see where you are now, bro, and you're a man who really just stands in so much gratitude. But it wasn't always like that, you know. And talk about it, bro, like, what does it take to really consciously be in that state? Because we miss so much moments. We miss so much moments to really, like, sit in that, you know.
Yeah, and I think gratitude is probably, you know, you said it right there. It's definitely an emotion or an emotional state that we don't appreciate. And I think the biggest problem is, especially with myself, is it wasn't until I went through the adversity, it wasn't until I went through the struggles of my life that I started to appreciate the fact that I get to live and breathe another day. So what I mean by the adversities and struggles that I went through in regards to, once again, putting on all this weight, that was a massive struggle for me. Drinking too much alcohol, that was a massive struggle for me. But all those compounding habits, it just grew every single year. And then it got me to a point in my life where, hey, I had the job. I was in the TV industry, living the best life of my life. But I wasn't the best husband. I wasn't the best role model for my girl. Everything changed. And once again, it wasn't, you know, just being grateful for the basic things in life. So for me, it took me to hit rock bottom. It took me to really hit the darkest times in my life to truly come out of that and realize that, okay, I've got to change this. Now, things need to change. And I think the biggest change for me was actually going deep in the inner world, the internal world. And that's what really changed my life, is realizing that, hey, if I can't, you know, let external events or the external world control my happiness, I can choose to be happy. I'm not my thoughts. I can control my thoughts. The moment I started living in this state, this is the state of being grateful. This is the state of being in that state of flow, because now you're taking control of your life. You're realizing that, hey, I actually have control of my life. How do I change it? By changing my thoughts. And going through this journey of changing my thoughts and my inner world, every single day I wake up in so much gratitude. I wake up in such a state of appreciation, because we tend to forget that we're so focused on the external achievements that we want to achieve in life or our desires, but we forget that, hey, just waking up, you got to be grateful for that, you know, to live and breathe another day. Like I said, 150,000 people passed away. You were blessed with another day. Mm. And just really emotionalizing and feeling that has really shifted my life to a whole new level.
Bro, that's so powerful, bro. And one of the sentences that I just picked up in that was the compounding effect of bad habits, you know, and I went through a similar sort of process. And for those who might not know what compounding is, it's just when you do one thing and you continue to do it over a long period of time, it turns into what might be a bad outcome, or in the best case scenario, if you're doing good habits, it's going to turn into a good, something good. But for me, I was the exact same, bro, you know, just got into that YOLO life, you know, and I feel a whole lot of people are really in that sort of state of mind and that way of living. Mm. And, you know, when I really, really like think back, I was so like, I loved it, you know, I was happy in that space, but on the come down of I'm not Hōrangi, or I'm just back into being in my room by myself, like, that ain't a happy and good time, you know. So,
and just going off the back of that, my bro, I always remembered going through these YOLO times, and I think a lot of people they resort to alcohol and things like that to really suppress the mamai, you know, the internal battle that you're going through, the scarcity mindset, the lack mindset. You are interacting with this every single day. So when it gets to the weekend, it's your time to try find that happiness. So you're resorting to the alcohol to suppress that mamai. And that's why I think it's really important for every individual to understand that, hey, you can choose to be happy right now. It doesn't take any external. It doesn't take the effect in order for you to change the internal world. You can choose to be happy. Think about the beauty of your whānau. Think about the gratitude, the things that you're grateful for. And just being in that state can really shift your level of happiness to a whole new level.
Because we really are waiting for a moment to be happy,
Exactly.
Like, maybe if I have X amount of dollars, or maybe if I get this job, or maybe if I get this girl, I'll be happy.
Yeah.
But what an anti-climax. Hey, what an anti-climax it is when you actually reach that moment, like, this is the moment I'm going to feel happy. But you get there, and you're already thinking about the next thing.
Exactly.
This ain't going to make me happy anymore, because what I'm thinking about now, it's bigger. Yeah.
You're always thinking about the next thing. You're always thinking about the next. And the reason why, you know, going back to that gratitude, why it's important, because it keeps you content, right? It's about, you know, I'm happy. I'm content with my life. Everything else that is manifested into my reality, well, that's a blessing.
Mm.
Okay, it's not always chasing the next best thing. You know, it's being in a state of gratitude.
Bro, that's so amazing, bro. And especially like when you're talking about, because I was a yo-yo diet guy, you know, I'd have like 12-week challenges and bro, feeling mean, and then go on the celebration sort of YOLO buzz for a week, and then I'm set back just 12 weeks of hearty mahi, and then I got into the state of just feeling really down about myself, didn't like who I looked, who I was in the mirror anymore. So I was like, all right, I knew what worked. It was a 12-week challenge, so I'll just do that again. Yeah. And it was never the same.
Yeah.
It was never the same.
And that's the problem with yo-yo dieting, my bro. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. Actually, diet don't work. Just listen to the word. Diet doesn't work, okay? So just going back to that, I think if we can, and that was the biggest drive for myself within Tawera Fitness, was showing people that it's a lifestyle. You know, you can still have the good foods, but within moderation.
Mm.
You know, you can still maybe have a drink here and there, but everything within moderation. It's about just appreciating life. And I think what happens is that we just overindulge
in everything that we do. It's just so easy to, you know, when you have that real feeling of satisfaction, like, oh, that's good, just one more, just one more. You know, because, like, how do you have that self-control?
Well, it's remembering delaying your gratification, okay? Is that everyone, it's always about striving for the instant gratification. But if you can live a life of 80% really, you know, sticking to your desires, sticking to your physical goals, your well-being, if you can stick to that throughout the week, well, you're going to have a great life. 80% really good, and then 20% leave that for the treat meal, leave that for the dinner with your family, or going out to indulge a little.
Mm.
So it's about, I think the reason why I'm really dedicated is because everything in life that you all the things that you truly want in life, they don't come easy.
Mm.
Okay, so you've got to be willing to
sacrifice. I think you got to say that again, bro. Like, you know, because it's so profound, so simple that once you really register what the bro just said, that everything in life that you really want, it doesn't come easy.
Yeah.
Like, you know, like that's a real solid sort of, you know, thing to say, bro, you know, and I think it needs to be talked about, you know.
Well, here's the thing is that, and this is the problem with Western society, my bro, is that everything is easy now. You know, you've got the Uber Eats, you've got we've got the internet, everything's at our disposal. And what that's done to our mindset, it's, you know, now we're always chasing instant gratification. We want the instant results. We want the 6-week shred. We want the quick fix diet plan, all of these things. Instead, it's about finding something you can dedicate yourself to and just go all in. Okay, yeah, it's not going to be easy. But if you sacrifice and you dedicate yourself to whatever it is, your goals, your desires, well, you're going to manifest that into your reality. But it takes the compounding habits, but it has to be compounding successful habits.
Bro, that's mean. And when you're sort of talking about sustainable sort of like changes, it was as soon as I went through my sort of yo-yo diet phase, that's what I started to really sit on. Like, how can I have sustainable changes where I can really just have this amazing sort of outlook on life and feel good sustainably? And it was when I really embodied the lifestyle of plant-based or veganism, you know. And like, I'm not a hearty advocate, you know, for this lifestyle, but I think what you sort of alluded to and just what I've mentioned, it was when you embody or dedicate yourself to a particular lifestyle.
Yeah.
You know, like, you know, I think that's really the sort of where things are going to change is when you commit to that.
I think that's the core shift in life. And like, it's with any desire that we want to bring into our lives, it's exactly that. It's about the embodiment of a new identity. And the same thing, like for myself as an example, every time I achieve a new milestone, I move on to the next, I must embody a new identity. What does that identity mean? It's about the habits. What are my habits? Are they successful habits? Yes. What are my desires? What are the things that I want to achieve? What are, you know, all of these things, they shift when you embody this identity. Now, why is the embodiment of a new identity really, really important here? Because it's the subconscious mind that's the creator mind. You can't shift your subconscious mind just by doing conscious work, you know?
Right.
5% of our lives is governed by the conscious mind. 95% of our lives is governed by the subconscious mind.
Wow.
So what I'm trying to say here is, hey, it's really, really hard to reprogram the subconscious mind, because the first 7 years of our lives
is where it's programmed.
It's where it's programmed. The things that we're told to us, you know, how we grew up, our environment, etc. So when you start to embody this new identity, you know, write it down on a piece of paper. What does this person look like? How does this person feel? What are his habits? Yep, no excuses. He goes to the gym. He eats healthy 80% of the time. He's dedicated to his desires and goals. Now when you have this identity in mind, when that old identity comes back in, you continue to shift. You move to this new, the embodiment of this new identity. Act like the person you wish to become. And when this happens, I can guarantee you, your whole life will change.
And it's not, and you're not saying that you become not yourself.
No.
You just become a better version of yourself.
Exactly.
You know, which is such a important thing. And one of the things that I've noticed in my journey currently is that I needed to really redefine my identity in order to be in a space of managing the space that I'm in at the moment, which is business, relationship, whereas the old self, my old identity, reached its threshold, and I was left like, why am I not feeling the way that I should be?
Well, here's another thing, is that we all want this new success. We all want this this new goal to be manifested into our reality. But the problem is yourself, if your self-image is not aligned to that goal, you're not going to bring that into your life, because people think that, hey, I'm going to work harder and I'm going to get a different result. No, you're not. You're still going to get the same result in life because of that identity. So that's why it's important to shift on that level. And you're totally right, my bro. I think this is a really important lesson for a lot of people, because, you know, we're always wanting to improve or get to that next level in our lives. But because we're stuck in the same subconscious beliefs, we continue to get the same results in life.
Bro, it's so important, like what you're saying, and it's like you have to, like you said, reach that sort of breaking point or that low moment to really sort of start to think about yourself a little bit differently. And even for some people who might be listening to this, they'll be like, how can my first 7 years really be governing me when I'm 30 or me when I'm 23?
Yeah.
You know, so can are you able to break that down as well as like what's the subconscious mind just for people who might not know?
Cool. Yeah. So how things work is we have the conscious mind and then we have the subconscious mind. Our conscious mind is governed by our five senses. So what we see, what we feel, what we hear, what we taste, what we see. And because it's only, we can only perceive so much because 5% of our lives is governed by the conscious mind. But unconsciously, the subconscious mind, which is the creator mind, this is pretty much, I'll give you, here's a simpler example. So the subconscious mind is like this. It's always recording every single time of the day, right? So the first 7 years of your life, it programmed that data into your subconscious mind. And the subconscious mind governs 95% of your life. But what does the subconscious mind hold? It holds your beliefs, your habits, your addictions, your values. It also holds your intuition. And those things right there truly sculpt your life. The conscious mind, though, can only process 40 bits of information per second, whereas the subconscious mind, 20 million bits of information per second. But why do I say this? Because every single one of us, we operate on a conscious level. The conscious mindset is the lack mindset. Mm. Okay, this is the reason why, because we're operating on the conscious level, we have a very lack mentality.
Right.
Okay, so when we perceive desires, life is always a struggle. Life is always hard. You know, it's gonna be really hard for me to obtain that goal because we're thinking consciously, right?
Yeah, right.
But we've got to realize that all of those, the old behaviors, our habits, our addictions, they're all embedded in the subconscious mind. So now how do we start to reprogram the subconscious mind?
Mm.
Through affirmations. How do we reprogram the subconscious mind? Through the repetition of new habits, of new behaviors.
Mm.
That's why the embodiment of a new identity is going to leave an imprint on the subconscious mind to truly change it. Now, why is the subconscious mind important? Because the subconscious mind cannot differentiate between what is real and what is not.
Yeah, beautiful.
But let me tell you the biggest thing about the subconscious, though, and why this has a significant significant role in our lives is this. The subconscious mind also controls our vibrational frequency. Okay, so what that means, if your subconscious mind is so used to you talking about it's hard to make money, so used to talking about life is a struggle, life is hard, well, guess what? The vibrational frequency that you emit every single day is that of lack, is that of struggle. So guess what? You continue to attract that back into your life. But when you start to reprogram that with this new identity, empowering thoughts, positivity, that of, you know, prosperity, that of wealth, that of money, that of abundance – now the vibrational frequency has shifted and you attract more of that into your life.
Right, that is amazing. And when I was like thinking of an example to talk about the subconscious, the thing that immediately came to mind was like when you sort of like get that urge where you're hungry, you just automatically end up at the fridge, not once, but like five times, and you just come away like, what am I up to here?
Exactly.
You know, that's the subconscious mind governing out,
exactly,
coming from the intuition, you
because
know?
Because your habits and your addictions and your values and your intuition is all in the subconscious mind. That's why it just comes naturally.
Yeah.
You just do it, you're like, what the hell am I doing this for?
Whereas if you reprogram the new identity, where you'll be like, oh, I feel like you've embodied this, I want to be successful and have prosperity, you're sort of like moving more towards, all right, I need to meditate.
Exactly.
And you're just doing that organically, you know? So it's just about creating those kinds of habits, right?
Yeah, and when those habits are compounded every single day, it shifts the subconscious mind because now it's become a belief. Now it's become a true value of yours.
Do you believe in challenging your values and beliefs? Do you think that that's like a healthy thing to do?
Yeah, I think it depends. But I'm always a big believer in challenging your beliefs and values because how are we supposed to grow?
Yeah.
How are we supposed to expand when we're stuck in our own little square, if you know what I mean?
So, right.
Yeah, I do agree with that. And I do see significant results can be achieved if you were
through that.
Yeah, through that.
It depends on people, right?
Yes.
On what their values currently are. Mm. If they are values where it's good, you don't really need to change that. You just need to enhance better habits, right?
Yeah.
But bro, in terms of like, because you grew up in Te Ao Māori, right? You didn't learn English till what, 14, 13.
Yeah.
You know, how has that sort of start of life helped you with where you're currently at now? Has that been were you ever rebelling against te ao Māori, or have you always embraced it and allowed that to sort of like...
I think I've been very fortunate because of the... My whānau is very Māori-oriented. So we grew up i te ao Māori, i te ao, i te pō. And for myself, is I only know that way. Okay, so I consider myself very lucky because it keeps me grounded. It keeps me... every time I'm working towards a goal, you know, I've got my whānau in mind. I've got my values in mind. I've got my te ao Māori in mind. So I definitely think it keeps me grounded every single day. So, yeah.
Bro, that's beautiful. And I think especially at the moment because of the narratives that is, I think it's really changing. I feel it's been changing at the moment because there's just amazing Māori kaupapa happening. Mm. But once upon a time, like, we're still seeing things online at the moment where Māori are just sort of like, sort of highlighting the negative things about te ao Māori. And because you're sort of aware of the truth of what it means to be Māori, how does that make you feel, bro? Does that sort of enable you to continue to try and do the real good mahi?
Yeah, I think for myself, if there's any, let me be real here, is for myself, I always let any negativity whatsoever, I either use that as fuel for my success, because if I get to another level of success, so does te ao Māori. So I think it does motivate me, it does inspire me. But my biggest journey here is, you know, every negativity that comes into play, so I see it on social media, I just stay away from it, man.
Stay away.
It does nothing to my vibrational frequency, it does nothing to my journey, but instead I'm going to lead the way. I'm going to continue to be successful as I can be, so we can get, you know, te ao Māori to a massive
better
level.
Place.
Yeah, better place.
And like, for you to have 3,600 current clients, that's amazing, bro. And the thing for me is, you know, you're a man who's actually walking the talk. You know, you're doing the mahi, and I think the clients that you do have, they are seeing, because there's no point in you being very unhealthy or being overweight and you sharing all of this knowledge with, and you're expecting your clients to do that. So do you use your program and your beliefs as accountability? Like, do you put a lot of that on you?
Yeah, for sure. I've always been, here's my saying that I live by: be the change that you wish to see. So, you know, me whakatinana I oku mahi. I've got to dedicate myself to my own mahi before I can teach it.
Yeah,
so,
right.
So everything that I do in regards to my health, in regards to my training, I do everything that my client does. My mindset coaching, I do everything that my clients do, because, you know, you've got to walk that journey first. Because if I can, like I said, I've won multiple competitions. I got the overall at Waikato NZIFBB in 2018. And if I can show that and my clients can see that, it's going to motivate them.
Yeah.
They're going to see proof. They're going to see results. So, yeah,
your message holds weight, eh?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
I think that's beautiful, bro. And one of the cool things that you've sort of shared to myself and the brother Hainu when we've had catch-ups was your pillars. Are you able to talk about them, bro?
Yeah, so the one thing that governs me every single day is just to always be aligned to our four pillars of life, you know, health, wealth, love, and happiness. So I wake up every single day and I always ask myself, how can I dominate these pillars? So I want to do something that's going to improve my wealth. I want to do something that's going to improve my health, my love, and my happiness. Why are these important? Because when one pillar is not at the best, right? Like when we're struggling financially, it causes disruption in the whānau, arguments, drama. But when we start to take care of those four pillars, you know, in terms of the love that flows throughout your whare, because you're happy, you're in a state of love, you're taking care of the kids, you're leading by example, you're keeping your health in good condition to have more energy for the whānau, and then you're making sure that that wealth pillar is filled as well. When those are consistent, it just, the unnecessary drama is non-existent. So I think it's really important that we all have that mentality. Like, how can we dominate those pillars? What can I do to improve one pillar every single, or improve every pillar every single day?
Bro, that is so cool. And I think that's a real practical tip for everyone who is listening. And I remember when I first heard it, I just wrote it down on a paper, you know, the four pillars, and I started just to put one thing in each and every day. And like, through that, I just started to feel mean. And one of the things in the love was, like, you know, just have quality time in terms of phones away, just have a conversation with Henipania. The health one was just go for hikoi, you know. And obviously life just catches up, but it's hard to really because I was a Māori identity, I wasn't able to sustain that sort of kaupapa. But, you know, what's your words of encouragement for people who might be in similar position that I was in, who are hearing this, it's resonating, they want to try and implement it, but they've got this sort of tendency to fall off the wagon from time to time? Cool. What does it take?
I've got the saying, mastering the art of showing up. And so what that means is, you know, let's use the gym as an example. I used this with one of my clients, and he was about 210 kgs. And so what I said to him is like, hey, let's just show up to the gym. Okay, I want you to turn up to the gym for 5 minutes for the next 5 days. He showed up for the next 5 days. And then after that, we said, cool, I want you to do 30 minutes for the next 5 days. He started to improve it. And why is it important to just show up? When you're just showing up, you're going to get it done. You're going to progress. Mm. You're going to move forward. And life is about constant progression. It doesn't necessarily mean that you need to go 100% every single day. But when you start to show up five minutes, 5 days a week, 20 minutes, 5 days a week, then you can slowly grow that. And what that means is, it's that going back to that compounding effect, right?
Yeah, right.
When you slowly start to improve on, like, as another example, you go back to your wealth pillar. What can I do to improve my wealth pillar? Cool. I'm going to start saving $20 every week. That compounded over a year is a significant amount of money. And it's just about showing up. It's just about dedicating yourself to those four pillars. You don't have to overthink it, you know, to make things hard for yourself. But, and just going back to that person, 210 kgs, he's now about 96 kgs, and he competed at Waikato NZIFBB and did extremely well.
Hey, what a story, man. 210 to what? 90? 200
to 96.
Holy, on stage. That is next level, bro.
And now he's a freak of nature.
Bro, I'm pretty keen to get into, like, money mindset, you know, because you've really helped, you know, me sort of create a better relationship with money. And I feel, you know, because of the common upbringing of, you know, indigenous peoples, not just Māori, with the majority have grown up with a lack, you know, so that becomes the state of mind. And going back to, like, what you said, we process things in the first 7 years.
Yeah.
So it's sort of like when we get to the stage of acquiring money, we fall into the 9 to 5 and we've sort of got a threshold of what we can achieve with the amount of pūtea we're sort of earning. Yeah. So how can the people who might be listening, or even just for myself here, how can we create a better relationship with money?
I think number one, it's about going back to that whole subconscious mind, is, you know, when we grew up, the first 7 years of our lives, or, you know, just growing up through our life, is the things that we heard is that money is hard to make. You know, money is the root of all evil. You know, people that have money are not nice people, sort of a thing. So we grow up with this really negative mentality around money. So it's really important, first and foremost, to switch those beliefs. Okay, so the reason why it's important, because money, and for me, you know, going back on a law of attraction basis, money is energy. And when you start to change that whole perception, you start to realize that money is not hard to make. It's just that I just need to change my whole beliefs. You start to change your whole beliefs and your thoughts around money. You start to realize that, hey, I can attract and manifest abundance into my life, but it starts with changing your thoughts, okay? So that's number one, you know, changing your whole mentality. Even around our dialogue, we always, you know, you hear a lot of my good mates, you know, oh, I'm too poor.
Yeah.
Right? That's a really negative dialogue, and that has energy. When you're talking like this, you know, be aware of your dialogue. Start to change your dialogue. How do you change it? By changing the identity.
Right.
That's why it's really important.
So how would someone else communicate that they're poor? Would they just, how would they say, oh, I got no money for that? Like, how would you change it?
Well, here's what I say with my girls, okay? We're out in the, we're going shopping, and the girls want to buy something. You know, the old self, you know, what I used to say is, oh, we can't afford that. But instead it's like, you know, bear with me. I'll find a way how we can afford that.
Okay? Right.
But just for now, you know, let's just think about it.
Yeah.
You're changing the dialogue. And once again, you're leaving
yourself open to receiving it, to buy it. Whereas as soon as you say we're broke or we don't have the money for it, you've immediately cut that line.
Exactly.
Wow.
But going back to the idea, and the reason why I'm going to keep going back to the identity shifting, because this is how I changed my life. I remember I could only make 100K every year, and that's all I could make. It was a struggle. You know, for me, I could never, ever get past 100K a month, then 100K a year. And then I realized that, shit, it's actually my identity, right? Aroha mai mo te kangakanga.
No, get the pie.
So it was my identity. So what I started to do, because in the subconscious mind, it was telling me that, hey, you're not worthy of that money. Mm. You know, you're not worthy of that. So what I started to do is started to act like the person I wish to become. I started to embody this new identity. What does this person look like? What does he feel like? How does he go about his life? The moment I started acting like this person, it shifted my subconscious mind. And that was the first time I broke the $10,000 a month to the $20,000 a month. And that's how I started getting to that next level of success. Mm. The moment I shifted that identity.
Far out. Yeah. That is like, that's amazing, bro. Yeah, why would people not want to change their identity? Is it the lack of awareness? Are they too attached to their self?
Too attached to themselves.
Ego?
The ego. Yeah, mm. Here's another thing. The ego is based in the conscious mind.
Wow.
So that's the truth. So when everyone's listening to the ego mind, the voice in their head, it's from the conscious mind, which is the mindset of lack. Okay?
What?
And another thing that it's really hard for people is they play the victim. And mm-hmm. this is the truth. So I'm going to go delve into this. And
nah, let's go.
It's like the majority of Western society, they're the victim of the past, victim of circumstance. They always have a very victim mentality. Oh, life is too hard. Life is a struggle. You know, my bosses are mean to me. The government doesn't pay me enough. So because of that mentality, you're always going to attract that into your life.
Okay? Right.
And that's the truth. But just imagine if you start operating, you started shifting your subconscious mind, where's the creative mind. Now you start to see life differently. You're more connected with your intuition. Mm. You're now realizing that, shit, life is abundant.
Mm.
Man, life is freaking amazing. But because people operate from their 5% lack mindset, they only see life through a victim mentality.
Wow.
So that's why it's really important to really delve in, start reprogramming the subconscious mind. And when you do, I can guarantee you start perceiving life differently.
So differently, eh?
Yeah.
And like for the people who are listening, like just really listen to this kōrero. If you need to pause it, just pause it right now and just sit back and just really look at the people who are either complaining about money,
yeah,
who are complaining about the government, who are complaining about their jobs, and just analyze, not from a place of like, you know, these guys, but from a place of trying to understand,
yeah,
you know, what we're actually talking about. Because when you can visually see it, you actually start to see that in yourself, and that's where you can change.
And I was that person.
Yeah.
And that's why I'm sure you've been that person,
100%.
Right? Always been that person. Oh, man, it's so hard. I'm never going to get past this threshold. Oh, it's, you know, I'm a moldy.
Mm.
It's always going to be hard. And money's hard to make. Money's evil. And no lies, I had these beliefs. But when I truly started to change and shift that subconscious mind, everything else changes. But here's a really important thing to remember. When you start to shift your subconscious mind, your reticular activating system changes.
What is that?
Now, why is this important? Reticular activating system is this. Say, for instance, you wake up in the morning and you get an email and it's debt, right? You've started your day in a really bad day, right? you're pissed.
Yeah.
Right? You start driving around on your car. What's your reticular activating system going to do? It's going to look around to find confirmations to say, yes, you are in debt. Yes, life is hard. Life is a struggle.
So you get a parking ticket, speeding
exactly.
ticket.
Exactly, and you start to attract more of that into your life. So why is it important to change our reticular activating system? Here's why. I start shifting my subconscious mind. I start, you know, going through my affirmations, meditating. I start my day winning my morning. I start my day with absolute clarity, positive thoughts. I'm driving out throughout my day. What's my mindset going to do? What's my reticular activating system going to do? It's going to look out for positive things to confirm my thoughts because I'm controlling the predominant thoughts of my life, of my mind's eye. Another thing is you'll find you'll go through Facebook. I don't see negativity.
Yeah,
I'm
right.
only seeing positive things. Why? Mm. Because my reticular activating system is only confirming the things of my predominant thoughts.
Mm.
This is really important because when you start to change your reticular activating system, the reticular activating system is pretty much the program in your mind's eye that's going around to confirm that whatever you're thinking about is absolutely correct. We start, here's another example. We start seeing coronavirus. We start believing coronavirus. My thoughts about coronavirus, all of a sudden, I start seeing it everywhere.
Yeah.
I start, it pushes me in a state of lack. It pushes me into a state of fear.
Scarcity.
It's because of the reticular activating system. So that's why it's really important to control the predominant thoughts that you interact with every single day. If it's positivity, if it's that of bliss, if it's that of love, well, guess what? Your reticular activating system is always going to search out things to confirm that to you.
Wow. Amazing, bro. And like, you've got a you just said you win the morning. Yeah. You know, what's your morning routine to get yourself sort of set?
Morning routine, I've been, this has been my staple habits for the last 3 years, okay? I wake up 4:50 in the morning. First thing I do is, the first thing I do for the first 10 minutes is I go through a rampage of appreciation. You know, just sitting there thinking about all the things that I'm grateful for, my beautiful partner, my beautiful family, my beautiful house, the mahi that I have. I'm truly grateful. Why am I doing this? Because I'm calibrating my energy, okay? Mm-hmm. It's so important to calibrate your energy. When you start in a moment, when you start your day in that happy moment, everything else flows. You start to attract more of that into your life. So start with a rampage of appreciation. After that, I'll go in, I'll sit down, and I'll start to meditate outside, right on my deck out there. So I'll go out there, I'll start to meditate, and I'll meditate for either 20, 30 minutes every single day. After that, I'll go into my journal, I'll start journaling, going through my gratitude list, and I like to go through 55 things that I'm grateful for to really get me to a state of appreciation. After that, on the treadmill, 45 minutes, and then straight into mahi after that. So those are the staples that I live and breathe every single day. If I'm on vacation, I must uphold myself to those habits. Why? Because those compounded over time have given me the results that I've achieved in my life.
And if it's working, why stop?
Exactly. Why fix it if it ain't broke?
Yeah, bro, I love that. And, you know, bro, I've been implementing some pretty good habits over the last, you know, month, ever since I sort of like had a bit of a breakdown, you know, reached the threshold of, you know, what I was sort of like going through. And I went down to Tangaroa and I just had this sort of like real shift where, you know, I changed my identity. Right, this is the person who I know I want to become in order to be able to have the life that I know I can have. All right, in order for that to happen, I needed to create a morning routine that could match that, because the real thing that made me burn out was just a lack of balance. I was just really going from a mindset driven sort of space where my health just went, you know, wasn't that great. Everything else just wasn't that good, but business from the outset and everything was looking great. So I just started to implement what are the four things for myself. It's sort of like the pillar, but it was going into the mindset, the spiritual, the physical, as well as the emotional.
Yes.
And my whole morning routine is just touching on every one of those pillars. As soon as I wake up at 5:50, I have a glass of water to rehydrate. Yep. I have my supplements for gut health. I get in the gym to move my body. I get home and have a shower. I meditate. I journal, and then I write down my list of things that I need to do.
Beautiful.
And
beautiful.
Every single one of those things is touching on trying to acquire those balance, those four pillars. Yeah. So my day is just like started, and ever since doing that, man, some amazing things have just happened. It's mean to start this morning, but I've had like my own experiences where, my morning starts mean, but then I get triggered, you know, and then that can really change the rest of the day. So how do you really start to look at those triggering moments a little bit differently, as opposed to like that triggered me and got me in a mood? How can I see that as a blessing, or how can I really just rinse my hands off it?
One thing that really works for myself is every time I feel triggered, first and foremost, I ask myself, where did this come from? Where did this belief stem from? You know, and it usually comes from the egoic mind. And so one of the things that I always do every single time when I'm in this state is, okay, I'm gonna remove myself from the situation. I'm going to go through breathing. If I need to meditate on it, I'm going to meditate on it. Why is this important as well? It's because I want to calibrate my energy again. When you're triggered, you're in a state of anger, you're pissed off, you're in a state of frustration, overwhelm. Your objective is to bring your state up to a state of joy or a state of happiness. And why is that? Because when you react to the situation, you're reacting from a place of aroha. You're reacting from a place of understanding. And I've used this, you know, as another example, if I'm going through like an argument with my partner, which we haven't had an argument in a very long time, but if we do, and I recall this one time, I was driving to Auckland to pick up my daughter, and whilst I was driving, I got a text, and I read it, and it really, really pissed me off, okay? So it triggered me, and I had been, you know, I started my day, I was vibing, I was feeling really good, but it really triggered me. So I put the phone down, I went through my breathing, and I started to recalibrate my energy, got it to a state of joy, a state of happiness, and then when I responded, my partner couldn't believe it. And it just really just destroyed that whole an unnecessary drama just because I was responding from a state of gratitude and responding from a state of actually understanding, actually listening to the text and understanding what she means, okay? Whereas at the start, I was like, oh, you know, and the triggers, the anger started, you know, taking over me. But because I, you know, relaxed, recalibrated my energy, I was able to come from a place of understanding.
And I think, honestly, man, like, I feel texting is a real good way to communicate when you're heated, you know, because you have time to, like what the bro said, you have time to really take in what they're saying. And if you have the maturity to come from a place of trying to hear their perspective and just allow them to vent, and you can process, you don't have to respond straight away, but allow yourself to sit in there and you can come from that place of aroha and understanding. And there's a real clear communication lines and you both feel heard rather than trying to go over the one another, you know. So, and that's something that myself and Henipani have implemented recently, and it's been so amazing. We've been able to get our points across. We were both heard. So, bro, and on that, you know, you're a businessman, you've got, you know, your darling, you've got a family. How do you balance it all, bro? Like, is, you know, like, I know you're gonna come back to like your day and all of that, but was there a time where it just was chaos?
I definitely know that when we first started working together, because she was a personal trainer out of Flex Fitness, then she came into the online space, so we started working from the same office. It was really difficult at the start because, you know, we're in each other's face every single day, every single day. But going back to one, I think one of the biggest things that really changed my whole perception was when I actually started being grateful for the fact that I get to work with her. And I think gratitude plays a massive part. And
it's been a common thing throughout this podcast, straight up.
And another thing as well was that, we live very, very busy schedules, very busy. Like, in regards to, I do a lot of filming, do a lot of traveling, running 4 or 5 different businesses. But we always make sure that we, at the end of the night, we have our last hour together, and there's always a date night every second week. And I think that's really just, it creates that balance.
You know, yeah, because it's beautiful, like health, bro.
Wealth, love, and happiness. We're dominating in regards to wealth, dominating in regards to health, but you got to make sure that love pillars is dominating as well.
Yeah, that's so important, bro, because it's so easy to really neglect that pillar when everything else is going right. And for me, bro, a thing that, you know, that I think I struggle with is when I take something on, I sit in it, and it's not in a space of I want to be there. It's just in a space where I really need to feel this emotion of yuckiness, of ugliness, so that I'm able to really, when I come out of it, that's it. I don't have to fall back into that space, because I think the thing that I've been seeing, especially with Ntani, is we bottle up a whole lot of emotions and push it under the rug. Whereas for me, when I'm feeling that way, I just sit in it, bro. And like, the vibe that I can give off is quite potent. And I really want to work on it, but I really don't want to take that easy option and just try and forget about it, because for my own experience, me acting in that way never turned out well. But I think there should be a better way for me to process when I'm triggered. You know, do you have any advice on that, bro? Because it's quite tough, bro. It's, like, you know,
I definitely feel that, bro. And I was that person as well. I would sit on things. Even to the point, I'll try suppress it, right?
Yeah.
Just suppress it. But once again, I think you've got to, I think our emotional guidance system is really important.
Yeah, sure.
So when you feel that way, you know, just sit in it. Acknowledge it. But I think there is a time and place when you've got to ask yourself, is it really, really beneficial, or is this really positive in my life, like sitting here? I think there is a time and place when we can be in that, you know, feel triggered, we can sit in that moment, we can allow it, you know, being in that state of allowance and going, okay, I can feel this mamai. Where did this mamai come from? Okay, cool. This mamai is really not me right now.
Yeah.
Why is that? Because your ego mind is creating all these stories, and you are not your thoughts. And I think when you start to realize that, now you start taking control of your life.
Wow.
You realize that, okay, that mamai,
I don't need to feel that. Yeah, wow.
Okay, and that's when you start to
shift. Does speaking, sorry to cut you off, but does speaking these out loud, does that actually create more power, or do you have to do that internally? You know, like, think about stuff, like, I know this ain't me, but when you keep it to yourself, you stay in it. Like, do you believe in voicing?
Yeah, I do, actually. I do.
Yeah.
one of my things though is, yep, voice. I used to voice. I'd go outside and just, you know, let it out, let it rip, right? But now I've got to the point where I can just internally talk to myself and have that internal dialogue. Actually, you are not me. Okay, and I don't want to be in the same.
It must be a powerful sort of feeling when you overcome that, eh, bro?
It is, my bro, because my biggest flaw was letting the ego get the better of me every single damn day. So when I was triggered, the whole world is going to know because of my vibration. I was in a nasty vibration. But the moment I realized that, hey, I'm the controller here. When I feel my emotional when I feel my emotions getting the better of me, just sitting there, understanding them, feeling them, but realizing that, hey, you're not me. You don't control me. I control you. Now I'm going to continually shift my energy so I get out of that state, because it's not really worth it being in that state, my bro.
Far out, bro. That is honestly the meanest and soundest advice, bro. So I'm really taking that on for myself. If anyone else just resonates with that, just please acknowledge that kōrero, because it's amazing, bro. And like as we sort of like get into wrapping up, you know, if people are really resonating with this kōrero, bro, how can they sort of learn more, go more in depth, dive deep into really creating a new identity, acknowledging more moments of gratitude? Like, where can they find you, bro? How can they get more involved?
Well, I'm on Instagram, Tiare Tawera, Facebook, Tawera Fitness. You can reach me on email, tiare@tawerafitness.com. I have a lot of coaching programs out there. The Awakening, we've got Puawai as well, which both help mum, dads, and males and females. Yeah, so, man, reach out to me. And one of the biggest things with myself is that I love giving back to people, man. I love helping people. And, we've got all those coaching programs. If there's anything that you're interested in, please join our whānau, and I'd love to help you out.
Bro, honestly, you're a man who pays it forward, bro. Like, you know, you really treat people with so much aroha. And, like, even my sister went on one of your programs, and she really felt the genuineness there, and it really like helped her in her goals at the time. You've helped me in stages of my sort of fitness journey. So, you know, I really want to encourage people to really take on the advice as well. If you want to go a step further, just go in and suss the bro out on his social threads. But to wrap up, bro, if there's anything on your manawa, if there's anything that you might want to share to the listeners to empower them, to encourage them, I'm just going to hand it over to you, bro, just to finish us off.
Kia ora whānau. First and foremost, a huge mihi to you guys for listening today. Thank you very much. Ka nui aku mihi ki a koutou. If there's anything that I want to leave you with, is really understanding the power of your thoughts, man. Your thoughts become your reality. If you're putting out negative thoughts, well, guess what? You're going to attract negativity into your life. Start shifting your life, you know, your thoughts to that of positivity, that of abundance. And when you start to truly control your thoughts, I can promise you it's going to completely change your life, and you're going to attract the life that you desire. So, kia kaha tātou ki te whai whakaaro ki o tātou whakaaro, kia eke tātou ki te rātou mata.
Beautiful, bro. Thank you so much for this time, bro. I've personally taken so much away from this, talking about money, talking about shifting our identity, more whakaaro around the subconscious mind. And I didn't even know that our conscious mind was only 5% of everything. So that was amazing takeaway for me. But ultimately, brother, just being in your whare, feeling your energy. And I just want to acknowledge you for what you have achieved. And particularly for where you're about to go and where you're about to send to. So from me, from the Planting Seeds community, bro, good luck with everything, and we got your back, my brother. Ngā mihi nui.
Ngā mihi
nui. Mauri ora, everybody. Hope you enjoyed the listen. Let's go.